In June of 1864, the war between the states was entering its final year, and one of the main thoughts that occupied President Abraham Lincoln's mind was the part played by Rome in the war. Lincoln said repeatedly, "This war would never have been possible without the sinister influence of the Jesuits. We owe it to Popery that we now see our land reddened with the blood of her noblest sons." This seems to be a strange statement by President Lincoln, considering what is taught today about the war between the states. Nothing is ever mentioned of a religious element in the war, or that the Pope and the Jesuit order were intimately involved. But Lincoln was not the only voice raised in opposition to the Pope's meddling in the affairs of this country at that time. Samuel Morse, the inventor of Morse code, traveled to Europe and Rome in 1830 to do his own investigation into the conspiracies hatched against America. After returning home to the United States, Morse wrote two books warning Americans of the threat from Rome. Morse would continue sounding the alarm throughout the 1800s and went to discuss the situation with Lincoln after his inauguration.
And Samuel Morse, of course, is the inventor of Morse code that was used for many, many years. And Samuel Morse wrote a book called Foreign Conspiracies Against the Liberties of the United States. It was published in 1835. And he shows in that book that the Holy Alliance and the Leupold Foundation out of Austria, controlled by the Jesuits, and the Jesuits themselves were the agents to overthrow the liberties of the United States, the Federal Republic of the United States, and to replace it with a papal centralized government as the Vatican is run.
But today, one looks around us to see U.S. presidents and congressmen and women groveling before the Pope. Lincoln's words would seem ironic. Consider this also. In April 2008, the President of the United States, George W. Bush, rushed out to meet the Pope at his plane. Does this not seem to be odd behavior? For the first time in history, a U.S. president went out to meet a religious leader, or for that matter, any leader, upon his entry into the U.S.
No president in the entire history of the United States has ever greeted a foreign diplomat like that. Ever. They wait until they're brought into Washington or something. They don't go out on the tarmac. This is a first.
What makes this even more egregious is that the current Pope is a former head of the Office of Inquisition and a former member of the Nazi Party in his youth.
You know, the Cardinal Ratzinger was the Grand Inquisitor of the Vatican before he became Pope Benedict. You're aware of that. I assume other people are not aware of that. For a Jew, the Inquisition has such awful, awful memories, and we are inviting the head of the Inquisition to the Jewish state. I gave a lecture yesterday, and these are the points that I brought up. You don't invite the Grand Inquisitor to Israel. It's that simple.
How did we go from a nation on the alert against the Pope and the Jesuits' desire to bring America down to one of accepting them as friends? Simply put, we have sold out. It has not gone unnoticed that several Protestant presidents have attended Mass and taken communion at Catholic churches. Since one cannot take communion at a Roman Catholic service if one is not Catholic, several presidents have misled their supporters into thinking they are Protestant when they are not. Furthermore, those in power are often Roman Catholics outright, so it is expected that they will obey orders from the Pope. From U.S. presidents to kings and queens to religious leaders throughout the world, those in power meet the Pope and bow down to him. Even when President Obama went to the Vatican in July 2009 to discuss the world economic situation, he too bowed to the Pope. Upon leaving, President Obama said, "We look forward to a very strong relationship between our two countries." It is important to remember these words of President Obama and what they mean. The Pope is not just a spiritual ruler, he is a territorial ruler. the name of his country since 1929, is Vatican City.
The Pope is a monarch. He actually, according to various books, the Pope is the monarch of the world. Not just a religious leader, he is actually a political leader. The Vatican is actually a small area over in Rome whereby the Pope is the ruler of that small area. The actual name Vatican I found very interesting. It actually means worship of the divine serpent. So we find that the very basis of the Vatican, the very word itself, means the worship of serpents.
But from Rome's perspective, the Pope rules over more than Vatican City. He rules over the earth, both spiritually and materially, or temporally. According to the Roman Catholic teaching, the Pope can keep you out of heaven, and he has absolute authority over you on earth.
And when I speak of the Pope, I speak of the papacy, that the papacy claims its two powers. Its first power is universal spiritual power over all individuals, that every person must be subject to the spiritual power of the Pope, that there is no salvation outside of the Catholic Church, which is the doctrine of the Council of Trent, is reaffirmed in the documents of Vatican II of the 1960s. It's still on the books of canon law. And the other power of the Pope, which is the second key, as you see the two keys in the Pope's flag with the triple crown, Lord of Heaven, Lord of Earth, Lord of Hell, and the two keys, spiritual power, the second key is the temporal power. And the temporal power is this, that the Pope believes he has the right to rule the government, the civil government of every nation. That temporal power has never been denied, it's never been disclaimed.
But there is no question that the Pope wields both swords, both a spiritual sword that the public sees, as well as a political sword, which most people do not see.
So it is very interesting and unsettling to those who love freedom and the right to worship God as one sees fit, to see our leaders submitting to the Pope of Rome. Now, let us revisit Lincoln's words. We have discussed the popes and the papacy, but what about the other group Lincoln mentioned? He spoke of the sinister influence of the Jesuits. Who are the Jesuits?
Jesuits are a group of people that were raised up right around 1535, 1540. Their leader was Ignatius Loyola. They basically had two purposes. One purpose was to destroy the Protestant Reformation. Because as you remember, Martin Luther had appeared at the Diet of Worms in 1521, stood before Charles V and the Holy Roman Empire. And so the Catholic Church sought to stop the Protestant Reformation that Luther began, and they couldn't do it. And so about 20 years after Luther stood at the Diet of Worms, the Jesuit order was created. And one of their purposes was to destroy every vestige of the Protestant Reformation, both in the religious realm, in the political realm, and in the economic realm, because the Protestant Reformation not only affected the religious arena, it also affected the political and the economic arenas as well. That was one goal of the Jesuit order. The other aspect was to restore the supremacy and dominance of the Pope throughout the world.
The Jesuit order has directed popes concerning policy, both foreign and domestic, since 1540, in particular, since the Council of Trent.
The Council of Trent, indeed. It started in 1545. It went for the next 18 years. That doesn't mean that they stayed there for 18 years. They met in different places. But over that period of time, the various leaders of the Catholic Church and the newly formed Jesuit order would come together from time to time and discuss how the Catholic Church would respond to the teachings of the Protestant Reformation. Would they accept them, or would they completely reject them?
So the doctrines that were being championed at the Reformation, the doctrines of grace, justification by grace through faith, justification by faith alone, sola scriptura, only the scriptures, by grace alone, through faith alone, etc., etc., no baptismal regeneration, that there is only salvation in Christ, that we do not participate in our salvation, it's not a joint effort of man and God, etc., etc., etc. All the doctrines championed by the Reformers were absolutely accursed and condemned and reprobated by the Council of Trent that the Jesuits really oversaw from 1545 to 1563. It was an 18-year council in the town of Trent, Italy, and that is the foundation of what we call the Counter-Reformation.
And the Council of Trent laid out the focal point, the direction that the Catholic Church would go for the next four centuries. Basically, at the Council of Trent, they decided that tradition and what the church fathers of the Catholic Church taught would continue to be the sole authority in the Catholic Church. Now, of course, there's other aspects of that, other teachings that branch off from that, but that is the basic sum of the Council of Trent, that tradition would still rule the Catholic Church. The anathemas that they have come out with that came from the Council of Trent to destroy heretics, to destroy those who would uphold the Word of God, those still live today.
That's correct. The papacy has not rescinded any of the curses set forth in the Council of Trent. In fact, the Council of Trent ends and says, accursed be all heretics, accursed, accursed. Every pope has to swear to uphold the Council of Trent. And if you read the documents of Vatican II, put together by Abbott, it shows you right there that every pope must swear to uphold the Council of Trent, even though in the 60s, when they were calling heretics separated brethren, with that delusion and illusion, they still did uphold the Council of Trent, as well as all the former papal bulls condemning heretics and calling for kings to kill them out of their dominions, like the doctrines of Pius IV.
The head of the Jesuits is the Superior General of the Order. He is called the Black Pope.
The head of the Jesuit Order is the Black Pope. The man who is currently there, he was just recently elected Nicholas Adolphus. The Black Pope is the head of the Jesuit order. He is called the Black Pope not because he is of African origin, but because he is in the dark. We see the white pope, we see Pope Benedict XVI because he's visible and all the world knows who he is. But the Black Pope remains in the dark, behind the scenes, and so few people know he even exists. But that's why he's called the Black Pope, and he's the one who heads the Jesuit order.
There is an ongoing war against anyone who resists the power of the Pope. And this war is directed by the Jesuits. This war is not waged openly by the Jesuits. The Society of Jesus moves in the shadows. They infiltrate and get others to do the dirty work of assassination. If armed conflict is needed, they use the army of one nation to bring a disobedient nation to its knees.
The Jesuits would do that very thing. They were very intelligent. They're still very intelligent people. What they would do is they would infiltrate. They did it through economics, through the merchants. They would then come in, start teaching. They were very wise people. They would then infiltrate not only into schools, but they then would infiltrate into local government and then rise up to higher government officials. We find that repeatedly in the book by Avril Manhattan called Vietnam, Why Did We Go?, where he talks about how they followed this exact plan throughout Southeast Asia. They did it in Japan. They did it in China. They did it in Korea. They did it in Vietnam. They did it all along the Pacific Rim. Well, eventually what would happen, you would have created Catholic cities where all the people in towns would become Catholics. Well, they would then try to put their Catholic ideals onto the major religious populace of a country. In the Far East, of course, the major religious populace would be the Buddhists. So these Catholics in these country, these converts to Catholicism, they would try to push their Catholicism on their Buddhist friends. And when the Buddhist friends rejected it, the Catholics would start to use force. Well, then the Buddhists would appeal to the local governments, the state governments, the national governments, and then there would be revolution. It got so bad in Japan that in 1639, the Japanese emperor, he said, no more Catholics, no more Europeans will come to our island again. And that ban stayed there for almost two centuries. This happened throughout the Far East and in other countries throughout the world.
Why has this assault on the non-Catholic world been ignored by most people, especially Protestant ministers?
Billy Graham is not, he didn't protest towards the latter part of his life. For the first part, I think he was solid when he first started. But along around the early 60s, his voice was silenced. Robert Schuller, Paul Crouch, Hal Lindsey, Pat Robertson, James Dobson, all of these men, they're not protesting. What they have become are agents of Rome. I remember back when I was starting my student teaching, I was teaching seventh grade history to young people talking about the Pilgrims and Puritans coming over to America. The book said absolutely nothing about why they were coming to America. And I was just reading, and I've got a book here called The Rothschild Money Trust, and also a book about the Rockefellers, The Rockefeller File by Gary Allen. But these people have set up trusts, and they have rewritten the history books. They have rewritten the history books so that the seventh grade history book that I was teaching out of said nothing about the Reformations.
We have to remember that the papacy, specifically the Black Pope, controls all high-level Freemasonry. That includes the Pope's Masonic Jewish Zionist running his Kingdom of Jerusalem. That includes the top Freemasons in this country, especially the temple there in Washington, D.C. That includes all of your big evangelists. For example, Billy Graham is a 33rd degree Freemason. Now, I know the Billy Graham organization denies that, but it's still the truth because we know, according to the honest 33rd degree Freemason who was truly converted to Christ when he believed the gospel and was saved by the grace of God, his name was Jim Shaw, that when he was inducted into the order of the 33rd degree in Washington, D.C., he said there were two former presidents there on that in that council, and one of them was Gerald Ford, a 33rd degree Freemason who pardoned Nixon, and the other was Jimmy Carter, 33rd degree Freemason. So there they are at the Grand Council. Another one was an international evangelist, which he later told others that it was Billy Graham because the publisher refused to put Billy Graham's name in there. So Billy Graham was there. So Billy Graham is nothing more than the high-level Masonic shill for the papacy, which is also fraught with Freemasons if you read the book In God's Name by David Yalop. And so we talk about Robert Schuller, for example. Robert Schuller is another 33rd degree Freemason. He went to Rome to get the Pope's blessing to build his crystal cathedral. And Robert Schuller is a personal friend of the anti-white, hateful racist Louis Farrakhan, who is another high-level Freemason who runs the Nation of Islam for the Archbishop of Chicago. So we have all these high-level Masonic leaders, black and white, of all these various different religions, working together for agitation among the peoples of this country, but never ever exposing the papacy as the true heart and soul and its real master.
All of this sounds incredible. It becomes less so when one examines the oath of the Jesuits.
We have to understand that these men have died to their own self-will. It's something a Christian should do. That's the way we should be. We have no life anymore. Our life is, we're dead with Christ and we're hidden God with Him. When Christ is revealed, who is our life, then we shall be revealed with Him in glory. We need to learn to die to ourselves and count our lives as nothing. That our only purpose is to do the will of our Master. And when He's finished with that with us, then let us die. The Jesuits have done this, but they do it for the devil. And so they have completely been emptied of their own personalities, and upon the order of their commander will do exactly what they're told. There's no such thing as a disobedient Jesuit. They're all under orders. They've been trained for 15 years. They're soldiers. They're more of a Marine Corps than the Marines. The Marines were fashioned after the Jesuit order. You break the man down in boot camp, you rob him of his personality, you shave his head, you put all the same clothes on him, they're all treated the same, they're treated like dirt, we're going to rob you of your will so that we can mold you into what we want you. That's all Jesuit. So, this is how they think. And given the order, they will kill you, me, themselves, their mother, anything they're ordered to do, that is what they will do. We're going to bring down 9/11 today, gentlemen. Okay, give me the order. What we do, what button we push, do I need to be inside, outside, what is it? And that's what they'll do. We need to bring down the Pentagon today. We need to blow up the Arizona in Pearl Harbor in 1941. Okay, I'll be there. What's my orders? They're all under orders. And this is why you can have no country with a Jesuit presence in it. They have to be expelled. And all their agents that they work through must be expelled. And this is exactly what Tsar Alexander I did in 1820. He kicked out all the Jesuits out of Russia. In 1822, he shut down all the Masonic lodges. And in 1825, he was poisoned. So this is the Jesuit mindset, and we should read the spiritual exercises. We should read some of their works. We need to read the Jesuit doctrines of regicide, how it's no murder to kill a heretic, how it's okay to lie, cheat, and steal, how it's okay to kill your enemy, how it's okay to kill a woman that you commit adultery with. If she should want to tell on you, you can kill her. It's all right in there in their canon law. It's okay to steal. The whole world is their candy shop, where they can steal everything they can get their hands on to consolidate it under the power of the Jesuit order. And if that means killing kings or sinking ships, even if it causes their own death, they do it for the greater glory of God. Ad majorem Dei gloriam.
When a Jesuit priest is elevated to a position of high command, he is administered what is called the Jesuit Extreme Oath of Induction. This oath has been called the Fourth Vow, or the Blood Oath, given to those in the Society of Jesus besides the traditional vows of poverty, chastity, and obedience. A copy of the Extreme Oath can be found in the Congressional Record.
I want to read a statement to you, which is the Jesuit Oath. It says, this is the Jesuit Oath. I do further promise and declare that I will have no opinion or will of my own, that's from the spiritual exercises of Loyola, or any mental reservation whatever, even as a corpse or cadaver, but will unhesitatingly obey each and every command that I may receive from my superiors in the militia of the Pope. I furthermore promise and declare that I will make and wage relentless war, as I am directed to do, to extirpate and exterminate Protestants and liberals from the face of the whole earth. I will neither spare age, sex, or condition. I will hang, burn, waste, boil, flay, strangle, and bury alive these infamous heretics, rip up the stomachs and wombs of their women, and crush their infants' heads against the wall in order to annihilate forever their execrable race. And then it goes on. The point being, throughout the history of the Jesuit order, they will shoot, They will burn, they will flay, they will do whatever it takes to destroy anybody who stands in the way of what they want to do.
In 2009, the Jesuit general was confronted about the oath.
One of the things in your Jesuit high oath, I think it is, it says something about, furthermore, you promise to declare that we'll, at the first opportunity, seek war at any opportunity against heretics, Protestants, liberals. See here? And that will spare neither age nor sex nor condition, and I will hang, waste, boil, flay. You've never seen this before?
No, I've never seen it.
Strangle, bury alive. Oh, it's horrible. And I was like, look, it's...
It's in the congressional record.
Thank you very much. Thank you for coming.
Does the oath and activities of the Jesuit reflect anything Christian? Or is it as Jesus said, "Beware of false prophets, which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves." What else do we know about the Jesuits? They have been thrown out of 83 countries over the last 500 years. That is correct. 83 countries have physically removed them. And why was it necessary to remove them? In a word, power. The Jesuits have throughout history sought to take over and control every country in which they reside. Since their beginning in 1540, the Jesuits' power grew until they controlled the papacy, the Roman Catholic Church, and many of the governments of the world. In 1773, all of that changed. One by one, countries began to expel the Jesuits from their borders. This culminated in the suppression or abolishment of the Jesuits in 1773. In that year, Pope Clement XIV officially disbanded the order forever. This providential act enabled a nation based on religious liberty to be formed, the United States of America. At the same time in history as the Jesuits were suppressed, the American Revolution occurred. Many believe this was no accident, but an act of God.
I see the suppression of the Jesuits as providential, because without the suppression of the Jesuit order, there is no successful American Revolution, period. We have to understand that the Protestants and the Baptists of Europe had been persecuted in excess of 200 years, crying out to the Lord for some place to live where they could worship Him and seek His face and be obedient to His word. That nothing else was more important to them than that. And so as a result, the Lord answered their prayers and opened up North America to them in the 1600s, but ultimately to get a government that would protect them in their rights of freedom of worship, freedom of press, freedom of conscience, freedom of self-defense, in what came to be the American Bill of Rights and then, of course, the U.S. Constitution. So without the suppression of the Jesuit order, there is no escape for us out of Europe into North America to start a free nation where we can worship God according to the dictates of our conscience.
As the Americans were determining and it's setting up a constitution where Protestant principles would reign, where freedom of religion would reign, where people would have the right to bear arms, where people would have a right to a fair trial, where all of these principles are being laid down, the Jesuit order is abolished. If the Jesuit order had not been abolished in 1773, and as they watched a Protestant country rising up in the Western Hemisphere, the Jesuit order would have used not only England, who they did use in the American Revolution, they would have used France, they would have used Spain, they would have used Portugal, because those were all Catholic countries. They would have used all those countries to destroy this growing Protestant nation. And it would never have been established.
Having had their power and influence greatly diminished, the Jesuits were unable to stop the American colonies from establishing a Protestant republic. That is to say, the Jesuits were in no condition to coordinate a crusade against the new Protestant Republic as they had done with England in 1588 by using the Spanish Armada. But the Jesuits had one ace in the hole. Many of the founding fathers were deists and Freemasons. They attended church services and publicly paid homage to the God of the Bible. But in reality, they did not believe in miracles or the divinity of Jesus Christ. Their God was the great architect of the universe, not the God of the Bible. Thomas Jefferson went so far as to create his own Bible by cutting out verses he agreed with and pasting them into a blank book. The verses Jefferson believed in were those where Jesus speaks of morality and loving others. Miracles such as the virgin birth or Jesus's resurrection were omitted since they were considered fables. Freemasons like Benjamin Franklin and Thomas Paine had little regard for the divine, miracle-working Jesus of the Bible. Thomas Paine, author of the famous pamphlet Common Sense, wrote a book called The Age of Reason. In it, Paine says, Jesus Christ wrote no account of himself. The history of him is altogether the work of other people. And as to the account given of his resurrection and ascension, it was the necessary counterpart to the story of his birth. His historians, having brought him into the world in a supernatural manner, were obliged to take him out again in the same manner. Thus, when it came time to create a document that would unite these colonies into one country, the Jesuits had an idea many preferred. It was called religious liberty. The First Amendment to the Constitution would allow all religions to exist in America, not just religions based on the Protestant Bible. In the new American Republic, Roman Catholicism was allowed to coexist with the Protestant denominations, as well as the deistic Freemasons. But most importantly, the Roman Catholics were allowed to vote just like any other citizens. This was key, as we shall see later on. For as their numbers increased, Roman Catholics could put in power other Roman Catholics, or those who were sympathetic to them, and change the nation from within.
After the Revolutionary War, voting rights of Catholics did change. We know that one of the signers of the Constitution was a Roman Catholic. There was only one, Mr. Carroll. But nonetheless, it made it look like a place for Roman Catholics to come, as well as Protestants, to have religious liberty, which is absurd. The Roman Catholic people had been used by the priests to kill us for centuries, and so why not stay in Europe? Well, they were being used by the Jesuits to come here to ultimately then take over political power and then submit North America to the feet of the Pope.
Turning from the happenings with the American colonies, let us take a moment to investigate what the Jesuits were up to in Europe after their suppression. As we might guess, the Jesuits were not idle. They decided to seek revenge against those who had turned on them, specifically a traitorous pope and the Catholic monarchs of Europe. In 1774, a year after the Jesuits were disbanded forever,
Pope Clement XIV had suppressed the Jesuits, and a short time later he was poisoned. Poison is a big thing with these guys.
Pope Clement stated, "Alas, I knew they would poison me, but I did not expect to die in so slow and cruel a manner." A post-mortem examination of his body revealed the presence of a poison. Thus, the Jesuits rid themselves of a troublesome pope. The vendetta on the Catholic monarchs of Europe was approached in a less obvious manner. Cleverly, the Jesuits determined not to act in their own name, but decided to work through front groups and to have them take the blame for their revenge. In this way, the Jesuits would continue to appear to be disbanded and innocent of any involvement in the matter. The first front group the Jesuits used was called the Illuminati. The Illuminati was organized in Bavaria by a Jesuit professor, Adam Weishaupt, on May 1, 1776, just 3 years after the Jesuits were disbanded. many sources only casually mention that Weisthaupt was a former Jesuit, and they usually state he was an ex-Jesuit. In reality, Weisshaupt never left the order. As for the order itself, it never was truly disbanded.
In Bavaria, when the Illuminati was founded in 1776 by Adam Weisshaupt, Weisshaupt is used by the Jesuits then to continue the work of the Jesuit order under another name. Weisshaupt never repudiated the Jesuits. That's a lie of many, many conspiratorial historians controlled by the Pope. They want to create this dichotomy between the Illuminati and the Jesuits. Never fall for it. Weisshaupt was operating under orders from a superior, Ritchie at the time, who was the general, then later another superior. But Weisshaupt then enters into an alliance with the House of Rothschild. So now we see the Rothschilds, the Jewish Rothschilds, Red Shield, become the bankers for the Jesuit order during the upheaval we will know as the French Revolution and Napoleonic Wars. So this alliance between the Jesuits and the House of Rothschild, these high-level Masonic Jews, is very important to realize at this point because we have to live with it and deal with it today. Also, Bavaria is the stronghold of the Jesuits. There was a huge inquisitional torture chamber there in Nuremberg. Interesting that the Nuremberg trials of the Nazis would be held there.
And the very principles of the Illuminati, the way the organization was run, it's the very principles of the Jesuit order. And that's found in Nesta Webster's book called Secret Societies.
In 1814, Francois Charles de Berckheim reported on Germany's secret societies and stated, "The oldest and most dangerous association is that which is generally known under the denomination of the Illumines, and of which the foundation goes back towards the middle of the last century. Bavaria was its cradle. It is said that it had for founders several chiefs of the order of the Jesuits." Through the Illuminati, the Jesuits sought to take over various powerful secret societies, especially the higher degrees of Freemasonry.
If you study all of the different organizations in the world, whether it be the Knights of Malta, the Bilderbergers, the Club of Rome, the Council on Foreign Relations, as you study all these different groups, and the Knights of Malta would be included in that, you find that they are like a buffer behind which the Jesuit order operates.
In his book, Proofs of a Conspiracy, John T. Robison wrote concerning the Masonic lodges. At this time, 1798, the Jesuits interfered considerably, insinuating themselves into the lodges. Robison went on to say, "This society is well known to have put on every shape and to have made use of every mean that could promote the power and influence of the order. And we know that at this time they were by no means without hopes of re-establishing the dominion of the Church of Rome in England." And with the Illuminati and the higher orders of Freemasonry, the Jesuits fomented the destruction of the very monarchs who had opposed them, beginning with the French Revolution and later with Napoleon Bonaparte.
Well, the French Revolution was launched and waged by the Jesuits using Grand Orient Freemasonry and Scottish Rite Freemasonry in England for the purpose of punishing the Roman Catholic monarchs of Europe, taking back the Vatican Empire from the Pope, tearing away the colonies from England, Protestant England. They were doing several things at one time. Remember, the Jesuits are the great Hegelians. They can think along 10, 20, 50 different lines at the same time and coordinate them all together. So to understand what we do, we have to think dialectically. We can never think linearly. So the purpose of the French Revolution, first and foremost, was to punish the Roman Catholic monarchs of Europe, and that they did. What happened? Why, they beheaded Louis XVI, the grandson of Louis XV. "We're going to teach you Bourbons of France who you mess with when you suppress the Jesuits." And then we're going to behead his wife, Marie Antoinette. And she was the daughter of Maria Theresa. She was a Habsburg. So we're going to punish you Habsburgs. You suppress us, we're going to cut off the head of Marie Antoinette using our Jacobins. And then you Braganzas of Portugal, we're going to drive you into exile using Napoleon. They did. They had to go into South America. And you Bourbons of Spain, we're going to drive you in exile too. We're going to have Napoleon set up a little banana republic up here in Spain. And then you Knights of Malta, how dare you kick us off your island of Malta in 1768? We're going to teach you a lesson. So they took Napoleon down here with his huge fleet, took all the treasures of the Knights of Malta and took all their weapons so that they could use that in the invasion of Egypt, at which time the Jesuits used Napoleon to kill all the Mamelukes, the bodyguard of the Caliph of Egypt. So now they're waging war against Islam like they are today.
When Napoleon's usefulness came to an end, the Jesuits had him betray his soldiers in a war with Russia. Like many of the founding fathers of America, the French soldiers were very nationalistic, and they would be a problem in the future plans of the Jesuits. After his defeat in Russia, Napoleon was forced to abdicate. Working in the shadows, the Jesuits made sure he was kept in reserve should he be needed. So Napoleon was sent to the island of Elba and given an annual pension of 2 million francs. Then, on August 7th, 1814, the unthinkable occurred. Pope Pius VII restored the Jesuit order.
The Jesuits were revived in 1814 with the papal bull by Pope Pius VII, which brought them back into existence.
The suppression of the Jesuits was to last forever. It only lasted 41 years. Former U.S. President John Adams wrote to Thomas Jefferson in 1816 about the rebirth of the Jesuits and the danger they posed to America. Adams stated plainly, "I do not like the resurrection of the Jesuits. They have a general now in Russia, in correspondence with the Jesuits in the United States, who are more numerous than anybody knows. Shall we not have swarms of them here, in as many disguises as only a king of the gypsies can assume, dressed as painters, publishers, writers, and schoolmasters? I have lately read Pascal's letters over again, and 4 volumes of the History of the Jesuits. If ever any congregation of men could merit eternal perdition on earth and in hell, it is this company of Loyola." Jefferson replied back to Adams, "Like you, I disapprove of the restoration of the Jesuits, for it means a step backward from light into darkness." Coincidentally, the restoration of the order occurred 1 month before the first meeting of the Congress of Vienna in 1814. The Jesuits were deeply involved in this meeting. When the monarchs of Europe began fighting among themselves, the Jesuits manipulated the circumstances to bring Napoleon back for an encore performance, the famous 100 Days. The monarchs gathered in Vienna came to terms quickly in order to meet this renewed threat. The Jesuits' careful manipulation of the events being played out like a chess game. Again, it must be remembered that the Society of Jesus never wanted to do away with kings. The Jesuits only wanted to punish those who had suppressed the order. In March of 1815, 9 days after the Congress of Vienna ended, Napoleon led his patriotic monarchy-hating men to defeat by attacking the wrong spot of the British lines at Waterloo.
The Battle of Waterloo was deliberately lost by Napoleon, as explicated by our great Southern general Thomas Jonathan Stonewall Jackson when he reviewed the battlefield. And you can find this in Dabney's great work, his biography that he wrote on Stonewall Jackson called The Life and Times of Stonewall Jackson. And when Jackson went there, he said, Napoleon attacked from the wrong position. He should have attacked over here. And that's exactly what happened. Napoleon deliberately sacrificed his army at Waterloo so that there would be the least amount of true patriots in France to resist the return of King Louis XVIII into France, who immediately restored the Jesuits and restored the Inquisition.
Having no further need of Napoleon, the Jesuits made sure he was sent far away to the island St. Helena in the South Atlantic. While there, he was poisoned and died in 1821. In his memoirs, Napoleon maintained his loyalty to the Catholic Church, but had this to say about the Jesuits. The Jesuits are a military organization, not a religious order. Their chief is a general of an army, not the mere father abbot of a monastery. And the aim of this organization is power. Power in its most despotic exercise, absolute power, universal power, power to control the world by the volition of a single man. We have stated that the Jesuits were deeply involved in the Congress of Vienna. Ostensibly, this meeting of the monarchs of Europe, under the direction of the Jesuits, was for the purpose of reorganizing Europe, restoring the balance of power, and discussing the creation of a federation of Europe. According to author Burke McCarty, the Congress of Vienna and several other secret meetings were in reality black conspiracy against popular governments.
After the Constitution is signed, Protestant principles are put in place in the United States. You go into the early 1800s. The Napoleonic Wars are being fought in Europe, in Russia. But finally, the Napoleonic Wars have stopped. All of the monarchs of Europe convene in Vienna, Austria. The man who headed it was Clemens von Metternich of Austria. Russia was there, England was there, France was there. They all came there to Vienna to decide on a big problem in the world. There were governments of the people, by the people, and for the people that were being established. And these monarchs of Europe and the Pope himself, Pope Pius VII, and the newly formed, reestablished Jesuit order in 1814, they all came together and they said, if we don't destroy these free popular governments, eventually the principles of those governments will destroy us. So at the Congress of Vienna, it was voted that they would pursue the destruction of any free governments in this world. And in 1814, the one government that was the thorn in their side was the United States of America.
8 years after the Congress of Vienna, the same parties met in Verona, Italy, for a second meeting to discuss the United States of America and the threat of popular governments. For posterity's sake, on April 25, 1916, Senator Robert L. Owen of the United States Congress entered into the congressional record the secret treaty of Verona that was signed by the monarchs of Europe. These kings of Europe, under the control of the Pope, called themselves the Holy Alliance. The first article stated, "The high contracting powers engage mutually in the most solemn manner to use all their efforts to put an end to this system of representative governments." The third article gave special thanks to the Pope for what he has already done for them and solicit his constant cooperation in their views of submitting the nations.
Now, the Treaty of Verona was an agreement between the Catholic monarchies of Europe and the Vatican to destroy the concept of representative government worldwide.
Samuel B. Morse shows conclusively that Metternich and the Jesuit order and Pope Pius VII, they all agreed that the way that they would destroy the United States would be by sending as many Catholic immigrants to the American shores as they possibly could. So thousands and thousands of Catholics were sent to the United States. Thousands and thousands of Catholic priests and many Jesuit coadjutors were sent to America to take over and destroy this government.
The treaty was signed on November 22nd, 1822 in Verona, Italy, by Metternich of Austria, Chateaubriand for France, Bernstedt for Prussia, and Nesselrode for Russia. After reading the secret treaty, Senator Owens pointed out that the threat under the secret treaty of Verona to suppress popular governments in the American republics is the basis of the Monroe Doctrine. This secret treaty sets forth clearly the conflict between monarchical government and popular government, and the government of the few as against the government of the many.
Because of the congresses at Vienna and Verona in 1814 and 1822, there was an English statesman who was at both of those meetings. His name was Lord George Canning. And in Burke McCarty's book called The Suppressed Truth About the Assassination of Lincoln, it says in there that George Canning warned the United States government as to what was going on. Canning was in contact with a man by the name of John Quincy Adams, who was a congressman at that time. He wrote to Adams, he said, "The monarchs of Europe, the Pope and the Jesuits are planning to destroy America." Quincy Adams took the information to the president at that time, a man by the name of Jim Monroe. We know him as James Monroe. James Monroe took the information, wrote to a former president who was still alive at that time. The man's name was Tom Jefferson, who was in retirement at Monticello. Jefferson wrote back to Monroe and he said, "This is the greatest affront to America since the Revolution." He said, "We need to do everything we can to oppose and stop this holy alliance set up by the monarchs of Europe, the Pope, and the Jesuit order."
In his letter to Monroe in 1823, Jefferson said he did not want to pass up an opportunity of declaring our protest against the atrocious violations of the rights of nations by the interference of anyone in the internal affairs of another, so flagitiously begun by Bonaparte and now continued by the equally lawless alliance calling itself holy.
America's response to these two congresses was James Monroe's State of the Union address called the Monroe Doctrine, where he told the powers of Europe, he said, "You stay over there, you fight your wars in Europe, we'll stay over here. If you ever colonize in the Western Hemisphere, we will consider it an act of war." That was the Monroe Doctrine. But in our history books today, we read nothing of the role of the Pope and the Jesuit order to destroy America. Nothing is in our books today to that effect. But that's why the Monroe Doctrine was written.
The Jesuits convened a meeting in Chari, Italy in 1825 to discuss tactics for dealing with the Protestant nations. Unknown to the 13 Jesuits gathered for this clandestine meeting, a young novice named Leone was in the adjoining library. Leone could not believe his ears and began to take notes of what was being said for posterity. An English translation appeared in 1848. What Leone heard was no less than the Jesuit plan for world domination and the destruction of heretics, especially the heretics in Protestant America. As to the Jesuit plan for world government, "You well know that what we aim at is the empire of the world. As to their plan for working in secret, let us prefer a secret war, which, though less brilliant, is more sure to bring us the advantage. Let us shun too much light." As to the Pope, also known as the Vicar of Christ, "We may say that God designs for extermination, like the Canaanites, all the nations that obstinately refuse to enter into the unity of the church, and that the Vicar of Jesus Christ is appointed to execute these judgments in due time." As to Protestant and non-Roman Catholics who do not join Rome, we have, however, one source of rejoicing. We cherish at the bottom of our hearts this principle that whatever does not unite with us must be annihilated. That Protestantism must therefore be utterly abolished. As to the Bible, then the Bible, that serpent which, with head erect and eyes flashing fire, threatens us with its venom whilst it trails along the ground, shall be changed again into a rod as soon as we are able to seize it. And what wounds will we not inflict with it upon these hardened pharaohs and their cunning magicians? The Monroe Doctrine was ratified in 1823. The Jesuit meeting in Chari, Italy, took place in 1825. 1 year later, John Adams and Thomas Jefferson died on the same day. Both of these former presidents and defenders of the Constitution died on July 4, 1826. What are the odds that these two men, so critical to the birth of the United States and enemies of the Holy Alliance, the Vatican, and the Jesuits, would die on the same day? The day they died was the 50th anniversary of the adoption of the Declaration of Independence. Autopsies were not performed on the former presidents, and it was assumed that they died of natural causes. Another strange coincidence would be the death of James Monroe on yet another 4th of July in 1831. Monroe left office in 1825 and supposedly died of tuberculosis 6 years later. It should be noted that the symptoms associated with arsenic poisoning, difficulty in breathing, dryness and tightness of the throat, seizures, and burning pain are similar to those of tuberculosis. George Morgan commented on these strange circumstances in his book, The Life of James Monroe. Morgan states, "As John Adams and Thomas Jefferson had died on the 4th 5 years before, Monroe's death added to the wonder, as though a power aloft had taken cognizance of the peculiar patriotism of these mortal men and had translated them." Is it possible that the power aloft was not from heaven and was not benign? Perhaps this power was not looking at the nationalism and patriotism of these men with joy as much as with a vengeful eye, as the Jesuit oath clearly states. A Jesuit vows to make and wage relentless war, secretly or openly, against all heretics, Protestants, and liberals, as I am directed to do, to extirpate and exterminate them from the face of the whole earth. That when the same cannot be done openly, I will secretly use the poison cup, the strangulation cord, the steel of the poignard, or the leaden bullet. Others have even pointed out George Washington's sudden death in 1799 as very suspicious.
There is evidence that the Jesuits assassinate a few American presidents before the war between the states. The first president they assassinated was George Washington. He was poisoned with anthrax. One of his three attending physicians was behind that poisoning. Remember, from the day he took sick to the day he died was a mere 2 to 2.5 days, according to Headley's great work, The Life of Washington. So he was murdered.
Why would the Jesuits want to kill George Washington? Like Jefferson, Adams, and Monroe, Washington was first and foremost a nationalist and warned against foreign influence. He promoted a policy of neutrality and the avoidance of European alliances. Washington repeated his isolationist policy in his farewell address that was published in newspapers throughout the country. Washington wrote, "It is our policy to steer clear of permanent alliances with any portion of the foreign world." Besides this admonition to avoid foreign alliances, Washington loudly declared America should keep itself free from foreign influence. "Against the insidious wiles of foreign influence, I conjure you to believe me, fellow citizens, the jealousy of a free people ought to be constantly awake." In addition to these publicly expressed opinions, Washington had acted swiftly to put down the Jacobin-inspired Whiskey Rebellion in 1793 with 15,000 troops. instigating the rebellion was the French ambassador, Edmond Genet, and the revolutionary democratic clubs that had sprung up in America. Genet and the democratic clubs were linked to the Jacobin clubs in France. In her book, World Revolution, Nesta Webster states, "These Jacobin clubs were organized by the Revolutionary Committee under the direct inspiration of the Bavarian Illuminati." The Jesuits created the Illuminati and were thus working through the democratic clubs in America. Washington never realized he was taking on the Jesuits when he crushed the Whiskey Rebellion. John Adams became president after Washington left office. During John Adams' administration, war with Illuminati-controlled France was averted, but Washington made it known he would not resist a call from Congress to assume command of the army. Furthermore, Washington endorsed the passage of the Alien and Sedition Acts that were designed to protect the United States from the extensive French Jacobin conspiracy. It is therefore no wonder that the vengeful eye of the Jesuits was focused on George Washington. After leaving office in 1797, Washington lived only 2 years and 9 months. From the onset of his illness in 1799 to his death was a mere 2 days. As with Monroe's death, the symptoms leading up to Washington's death were difficulty in breathing, tightness of the throat, and burning pain. Washington was only 67 years old when he died. Like Jefferson, Adams, and Monroe, there was no autopsy with Washington's death. However, the Jesuits made sure they had a servant on hand, Tobias Lear, to carefully plant the story that Washington had neglected to take off his wet clothes after coming in from his day of riding about his farms in snowy weather. Washington had taken cold, undoubtedly from being so much exposed the day before, and complained of a sore throat. Lear said this even though Washington explicitly told him that his great coat had kept him dry. According to Lear, we are to believe that George Washington, who survived the hardship of a winter at Valley Forge and other severe winters, did not know how to take care of himself in bad weather. The more likely truth is that Washington had opposed the plans and schemes of the Society of Jesus and was assassinated for his interference. Other American presidents, both in the 19th and 20th centuries, who would run afoul of the Jesuit order, would meet untimely deaths. For instance, the short presidency of William Henry Harrison. Harrison had been elected president on March 4, 1841. He would serve as president for only 35 days. At the end of March, the newly elected president came down suddenly with an illness and died. Many thought this was the result of his long inaugural address, which lasted over 2 hours in cold weather. But Harrison had been fine after the speech, and weeks had passed since the inauguration. Why was Harrison assassinated? One only has to go to his inauguration address to find the main reason. Harrison stated in the fourth paragraph of his speech, "We admit of no government by divine right," believing that so far as power is concerned, the beneficent Creator has made no distinction amongst men, that all are upon an equality, and that the only legitimate right to govern is an express grant of power from the governed. Like other leaders in the past, Harrison was thumbing his nose against the Holy Alliance, who practiced the divine right of kings to wield power as sanctioned by the Pope. Harrison was also unwilling to accept Texas, a slave territory, into the Union, which ran against the Jesuit plan of using the slave issue to agitate and divide the northern states from the southern states. Unlike Adams, Jefferson, and Monroe, the Jesuits did not wait for the 4th of July to eliminate the heretical President Harrison. Harrison was poisoned at the end of March and died on April 4, 1841. Vice President John Tyler succeeded Harrison as president. The annexation of Texas was accomplished in 1845 under the watchful eye of the new president. Another president who died suddenly in office was Zachary Taylor. Taylor was elected president in 1848. Taylor was a Southern slaveholder who did not want to see slavery extended to any more areas of the country. Like Washington, Taylor was devoted to the Union of the American States, was very popular, and was a military man. Another crisis over slavery occurred by the Jesuits in 1850. A compromise was being pushed to avert a split in the Union. Taylor did not like the compromise being worked out in Congress. On July 4th, 1850, Taylor attended the groundbreaking ceremonies for the Washington Monument. He was fine upon returning back to the presidential mansion. Then he became ill after eating some raw fruit that some say was a bowl of cherries. A violent fever came upon him. Senator Benton commented that the violent attack commencing soon after his return to the presidential mansion. Old Rough and Ready frustrated his assassins and managed to fight the poison for 5 days and avoided the 4th of July curse. President Taylor died on July 9th. The Jesuits removed a strong, unifying leader and replaced him with a more malleable president in Millard Fillmore. Fillmore signed the compromise in 1850, just 2 months after Taylor's death. As the Jesuit agitation of the American states was reaching its climax in the 1850s, a trial occurred in 1855 at a courthouse in Illinois that would bring two fateful men together. These two men would join forces to fight the Jesuits. The first was a rebellious Roman Catholic priest by the name of Charles Chiniquy. The second was a lawyer by the name of Abraham Lincoln. Charles Chiniquy did not approve of the corrupt conduct of many of the priests he knew. These evil priests were drunkards, sexually promiscuous, and thieves, often stealing money and property collected from their parishioners.
The priesthood in Chicago was very corrupt, morally and every other way. They were drinking heavily. They would go on these retreats and take up a collection between themselves, put it all in a pot, and go out and buy a lot of booze. And they also rented a lot of hookers. Apparently there was a lot of sexual deviance going on at the time as well. And he didn't like that, though, and he tried to change it. He quoted exclusively from the Bible, and his bishop just could not tolerate that.
The heads of the Roman Church wanted Chiniquy to ignore these illicit and illegal activities. When he did not, Bishop Reagan of Chicago and another priest by the name of LaBelle arranged to have Chiniquy accused of rape. Chiniquy needed a good attorney. An attorney by the name of Abraham Lincoln was suggested.
Abraham Lincoln had a team of other lawyers under him, right? It's like a regular defense team. Lincoln being one lawyer, a gentleman by the name of Stephen R. Moore was another lawyer. And that was a big court case at the time. It was the most important court case that Lincoln ever had in his entire legal career, as a matter of fact. But it's been buried by the Illinois government.
The trial did not go well for Chiniquy. The general feeling was that he would be convicted.
Local newspapers of the time, they speculated that Chiniquy was going to be found guilty. And that was being broadcast throughout the entire Catholic community at that time.
Fortunately for Chiniquy, a witness came forward for the defense. Her name was Philomene Schwartz. Miss Schwartz had been in Father LaBelle's house the day the plot to frame Chiniquy had been concocted. Schwartz contacted Lincoln and agreed to testify.
She caught the midnight train to Urbana and met up with Abraham Lincoln and explained to him exactly what happened.
Once Bishop Reagan and Father LaBelle found out about the potential witness, they fled the city. The prosecution dropped the charges, and Chiniquy was vindicated. As they left the courtroom, Charles Chiniquy was in tears.
Lincoln says to him, "Why are you crying, Mr. Chiniquy?" He says, your enemies have fled, and you are free to go. And he said, "I'm not crying for myself, Mr. Lincoln. I'm crying for you." He said, "Because I saw no less than 11 Jesuits with the sentence of death on their face today in this courtroom, and know for a surety they will kill you for what you have done." Lincoln says, "Well, then let this be my death warrant," and he gives Chiniquy a bill for a mere $50. And then Lincoln sobers up and said, it matters not where a man must die, but that he must die at the post of duty and honor.
Chiniquy's words of warning to Lincoln would prove to be true. The conspiratorial hand of the Jesuits at work, a conspiracy to further their goal of a world under papal control. Abraham Lincoln was elected President of the United States 5 years after Charles Chiniquy's trial. By 1860, agitation between the North and the South was so great that many of the Southern states decided to leave the Union over Lincoln's election. This agitation was designed from the beginning to drive a wedge between the North and the South and bring about a war that would result in the death of countless Protestants, clearing the way for the Jesuits to reconstruct America into a tool of conquest.